We are reaching the end of the sudoedit exploit series. We have researched the bug and understood it well enough to write a first proof of concept exploit, overflowing the service user struct name, which leads to a shared library of our choice being loaded, which then is executed as root. But the whole thing just worked on our test setup. Now it's time to move what we know over to a real target, Ubuntu 20.04, Focal Fossa. I just selected a bit older Ubuntu version, which still had a vulnerable sudo version, and our goal is to create a working exploit against that version.
So, after downloading and installing everything and confirming that sudoedit is still vulnerable on the system, let's copy over the files and scripts that we created in the last video. Specifically, we want asd5.py and the GDB watcher to collect crash information and find the backtrace with tsearch and NSS lookup function. And we need sudoenv2 and sudoenv3. Sudoenv2 is the regular one, just calling sudoedit, and sudoenv3 is the one with the get sha waiting for the user to hit the key before it calls sudoedit. Also, all the paths of the scripts have to be adjusted. In my case, I place everything in the documents folder. And then there's one last setting to change. When we crashed sudoedit as a test, we got this pop-up from the system. A problem, or rather a crash, was detected. This appears because the core files, so crash information, is set to be forwarded to upward. Because we want to have a lot of crashes and do not want the crash reporting to interfere, let's disable this upward service. Also, if you paid close attention, you might notice that I forgot to copy the malicious shared library inside the xxxx folder. Our exploit strategy is to make sudo dlop in this library, so yeah, you can imagine I run into weird issues until I realize that mistake. Anyway, we are basically ready to roll. Executing asd5.py as the user and the GDB watcher as root to collect the crashing stack traces. And we let that run. Maybe you are wondering why the stack traces look different to before. That's because we are running against a sudo version without debug symbols. We run against the standard sudo version on Ubuntu. We didn't build this one ourselves. That's why we don't get any function names from sudo. But libc has symbols, so we can see the functions where we crash in libc. And that's enough for us, because we are looking for NSS-related crashes in libc. By the way, I also found a small issue that could have been a problem in the last video. Here's a typical backtrace, and we want to extract the function names. Some of them are just there, and others have the address before. And my logic was very basic, and I only extracted the ones that had an address. You can see that in the data we logged in the feng shui cases a few episodes ago. Here you can see the file name was nsslookupfunction, even though the actual top function was tsearch. Now, that is not a huge issue, we can still see it in the file that we crashed in tsearch. But I was also limiting the file size to not collect megabytes of data. And now look at this backtrace. The topmost functions here are NSS new servers and NSS load library, but NSS lookup function is the first with an address. So a tsearch crash could have the same file name as this one, even though they are different crashes. And so if this one is more common and fills up the file, any rare tsearch crash will never be logged. So that is the theory I have why it didn't work last video. But I didn't verify, and maybe sudo in the Docker container just doesn't have a heap layout where we can find the conditions we want. Anyway, back to our Ubuntu VM. This script is now properly logging the crashes, and it took a few hours, but eventually I found a tsearch crash. Actually, I found two different cases. And when I saw that, I was so excited, because to me that meant we already won. So I did what we basically did two episodes ago. We extract the test case and put it into a new script asd6.py. Did you expect a better name? Anyway, we should also use the sudoenv3 wrapper because it waits with getchar before executing sudoedit. This way we have time to use a root shell to attach gdb to this setuid process. And with gdb we can then see what happens. Now, if you look closely, the backtrace is different from the backtrace we had in our Docker research. The NSS next tool calls are totally new to me, never seen them before. But keep in mind that NSS is acting based on the information in /etc/nss-switch.conf, and the group and passwd information is only backed by file in Ubuntu Docker, while the actual full Ubuntu VM also has systemd. So the whole objects allocated for handling NSS stuff is probably different on here, leading to different objects overwritten and crashing. But I'm just guessing, I don't know to be honest. Either way, we seem to crash in the right function, NSS lookup function and tsearch. Though another issue I noticed was that we didn't really overwrite the values in the NI struct, but we overwrote the whole pointer to NI, and that's not what we want. But do you remember this? We had something similar before, and the backtrace was NSS next to, and we know that the NI struct has the next pointer. If this pointer was overwritten, so if a particular NI struct was overflown and we take this pointer and pass it to the next function, we would have exactly this case. So I assume this value would be the next pointer of another NI struct. So maybe we could still turn that into the condition we want. But let's look at the second tsearch crash. Maybe that one is better? It was coming from getGroupList, and actually that is closer to the crash we had before. This one made me feel more comfortable because it was more familiar, so I wanted to start with this condition. But it had the same issue. The NI pointer is 6B6B6B6B. So I assume the same. Hopefully there was another NI struct with this as the next pointer. And now I just did exactly the stuff I did in episode 15. We basically want to set them all to 0 and control the name. 6b is the lowercase letter k, so we assume we overflowed the struct with the case. We can use a pattern from this website here to find the offset, replacing the case with the pattern and letting it crash again. Now we get the pattern value and we find the offset. So let's replace that with zeros. And that is just the iterative explorative loop I do now. Always look at the crashes, looking at the offsets, and trying to get an NI struct with the pattern I want. Eventually I crash in a different place, and that one now looks exactly like the crash we had in episode 15. We are in NSS load library, and another NI struct is partially overwritten. Now we just have to perfectly control the overwrites, here setting the name to xxxLiveOverflow. And now we just need to get the library and known to null as well. Now it should work. At least I thought so. I don't see the expected output. Oh, I just noticed I forgot the xxx folder with the malicious shared library. So let me fix that. Let's try again. And there we have it. We executed code as root.
We did it. I cannot believe it. We actually did it. We created a root exploit for Ubuntu 20.04 Focal Fossa.
Now, what we could do is just clean it up a bit, trying to search which values we can remove that do not matter for the exploit. You can always just remove something and see if the exploit still works. Some of the environment variables seem irrelevant, and we can replace the long strings with shorter string multiplication. And I also noticed some of the attempted null overflows are unnecessary as well. In the end, this is the minimized test case. Awesome. For further testing, I also created another unprivileged test user just to see if the exploit is stable. And when executing it as a test user, it also worked. Perfect. We are done. This is the end of the sudoedit series. But there's one last treat I have for you. When I ran the brute force script to collect crashes earlier, I did actually log all the crashes that were NSS related in a file, including the offset lengths for the buffers. And we can now grep for all the tsearch crashes and look for patterns. Do you see how almost in all cases where we crashed in tsearch, the argument used for sudoedit -s was around 232 characters long? And the first environment variable following it was in the lower hundreds. And the tset environment variable is around 213, pretty precisely. we were brute forcing length values up in the multiple thousands for all of these variables. And only when we got lucky, where the argument minus s was roughly 232 characters long, the second environment variable was in the lower hundreds, and the tset variable was roughly 212 to 215, only then we got the tsearch crash. So you can do a bit of math probability calculation how likely it was to find that exact crash. If we now modify our brute force scripts to restrict argv and the first env variable to those lengths, we suddenly get constantly crashes in NSS related values and tons of more tsearch crashes. I think it's interesting to see the probabilities of fuzzing and finding the correct values for crashes we want. Try to keep that in mind when fuzzing. You never know which changes to the fuzzing could have significant impact on the type of crashes you find.
That's it. That was the sudo vulnerability research, step by step, in excruciating detail. I'm grateful for every one of you who stayed with me until the end. I hope you are as excited as I am to have developed this exploit together and that you learned more about the process of vulnerability discovery and exploitation. I definitely learned a lot as well. Thanks again for all the patrons and YouTube members supporting this kind of series. I hope you are all satisfied with the result. And now that the series is complete, I would highly appreciate if you would share the GitHub link with all the videos and files, or directly the YouTube playlist with friends and colleagues so this series doesn't go to waste. By the way, on my second channel, I have watched the episodes also on stream. They are very long videos and I use them to provide additional context and answer questions. So if you have trouble understanding a certain episode, maybe check out those videos. Or join me live on the next one on twitch.tv/liveoverflow. Thanks for sticking around.